Hi everyone, welcome back to English 484W. So this week we have two more short stories to add to our kind of collection to this point. And going through this reading list, I almost want to apologize because it is kind of just this litany almost, or collection of just kind of terrible men. So hopefully you guys are doing okay kind of just reading these stories about very kind of difficult material that's kind of just being juxtaposed week after week. But hopefully the two short stories that we're reading this week, they can maybe shift the conversations that we've been having a little bit into different areas. So with this video, I'm just going to be talking a little bit about the short story by Mary Sauf, You Will Never Be Forgotten, and some of the themes in the story that I was particularly interested in, and I think kind of maybe give useful context to the story. So I'll just get into my PowerPoint. Okay, so I just want to start with just a video from Mark Zuckerberg and his kind of most utopian talking about Facebook. And I think this video is a little bit relevant to what's going on in Mary Sauf's story. It's set in Silicon Valley. There's a lot of kind of techie bros that are advancing this, I'd say, ideology about how technology can improve the world. And certainly I think that technology can improve the world. We're doing this online course through technology mostly, so this course wouldn't be happening without technology. But there's also kind of a dark side perhaps to technology as well that we should always be thinking about. So, but here's the video from Mark Zuckerberg, and I apologize, the audio might be just a little bit weird, but we'll see how it goes.
As I look around and as I travel around the world, I'm starting to see people and nations turning inward against this idea of a connected world and a global community. I hear fearful voices calling for building walls and distancing people they label as others, for blocking free expression, for slowing immigration, reducing trade, and in some cases around the world, even cutting access to the internet. It takes courage to choose hope over fear, to say that we can build something and make it better than it has ever been before. You have to be optimistic to think that you can change the world. And people will always call you naive, but it's this hope and this optimism that is behind every important step forward. Our lives are connected. And whether we're welcoming a refugee fleeing war or an immigrant seeking new opportunity, whether we're coming together to fight global disease like Ebola or to address climate change, I hope that we have the courage to see that the path forward is to bring people together, not push people apart, to connect more, not less. We are one global.
Okay, so I think the most important part of that video is near the end, where Zuckerberg talks about wanting to connect people more rather than separate them. Although we've seen just with kind of recent events like the Trump election or something like that, or the politics in America right now, there's a lot of technology. I think Trump has admitted that without social media, he would never have been elected. So social media in the American context is not really connecting people, but it is kind of doing the opposite of what Zuckerberg wants social media to do, which is connect people. Rather, social media can also, as we see just the evidence every day, can also separate people. And the Mary Sauf story really gets into why we want to connect to other people, or at least the dangers involved with connecting to strangers. And I just want to add a little note on top of the Zuckerberg video, that the creation of Facebook, at least as it's documented in the film The Social Network, directed by David Fincher, which was based on a lot of kind of real life events from Zuckerberg's life. So the creation of Facebook kind of spiraled out of a breakup that Zuckerberg had with a woman, where he blogged about her very negatively, calling her a bitch and just kind of tearing her down on the internet, which kind of led to his development of the application FaceMash, which was used for comparing pictures of women and kind of judging their attractiveness. In his blog post, he also commented on comparing the attraction of women to farm animals as well. So there's some underlying misogyny there. I mean, this is going back to kind of college age Zuckerberg, so probably things that maybe hopefully he's ashamed about now. But even the creation of Facebook kind of spiraled out of this breakup. At least that's how it's depicted in the social network. So there's still some kind of gender politics that are underlying even something seemingly as neutral as Facebook. Okay, and then I just have a little bit of a critique from Marxist theorist Jody Dean about the kind of the politics that social media advances. And that's mostly just about how we can, on the internet, we can kind of feel that we're contributing to political movements. So for example, feminism. We can feel we're contributing to feminism by just sometimes clicking, by clicking share when we share like a feminist article, or we retweet a feminist commentator, or we just we read our Twitter feeds and there's a lot of just feminists there. We can feel like we're contributing to feminism as a political movement a lot of the time just from sitting at our computer, which there are obviously some problems to that. To feel like you're a feminist just by what you do on the internet, which often doesn't really require any effort. To retweet something or to like something doesn't require any kind of personal change or anything. We can also use social media to broadcast our politics in a way that might not completely match up with how we actually are behind the computer screen. So Jody Dean's just a really brief quote here is that communicative capitalism, so the kind of capitalism that capitalizes on our kind of daily communication, primarily through the internet. So an example of communicative capitalism would be something like hashtag Bell Let's Talk, which is like a cell phone company whose mission is to help people deal with mental health. But how do they help them deal with it? By making people communicate more. So it's always kind of about making people communicate more. And in that communication, there's obviously a lot of kind of information that a lot of these companies can use to kind of extract data or extract value from by reselling it to advertisers. So communicative capitalism is basically the extraction of value from our increased need for communication. So her quote is that communicative capitalism describes the materialization of ideals of inclusion and participation in information, entertainment, and communication technologies in ways that capture resistance and intensify global capitalism. So Jody Dean, very kind of negative about the kind of the, I think it, she describes it as like click activists. So activists that they primarily just pursue their political beliefs through the internet rather than participating in actual kind of movements like marches or gatherings or protests. Although there's also kind of a lot of pushback against her position that internet activism can go hand in hand with on the ground activism. So yeah, just something to think about. Okay, so how is techno-utopianism reflected in Mary South's story? So there is the character, the villain of the story, the rapist, who is kind of presented as one of these kind of tech bros. And I just have images of tech bros. So Jack Dorsey on the left, who is the CEO of Twitter, Elon Musk, and Jeff Bezos, just kind of random who came to mind when I was thinking of tech bros. And I think the rapist is definitely kind of presented in this line of being a kind of a tech bro. So he has this line, techies are the latest REM cycle in the American dream. He declares cleverly, we're making the lives of these people better. So a lot of these, kind of social media companies, they do have this kind of very liberal politics. Like even for the company that the protagonist works for, which is the world's most popular search engine, which I'm assuming is Google. So Google long held the mandate, don't be evil. And Google has always had this kind of liberal politics to it. So very kind of inclusive, even platforms like Facebook are very kind of inclusive. So when it comes to things like a person's gender, Facebook gives a lot of different options for a person to kind of define their gender. So it's very inclusive and liberal in these ways. None of these social media platforms have like a conservative politics, I don't think. They're all kind of very liberal. They permit kind of a lot of kind of expression of new types of identity. So yeah, so there is kind of a lot of kind of, these companies are trying to present themselves as good, but yeah, there can be a little bit of, there can be some problems with them as well. And the story kind of points that out in this conversation that the protagonist, who's just called the woman in the story, has with the rapist's new girlfriend in the John. So the protagonist says, aren't you concerned that your app, and this app is called Tender Buttons, and it's basically just for putting people into contact with each other, into contact with strangers, for the basic purpose of connecting. Which, yeah, I'd be curious what you guys thought about that app, whether it would be something that you would be interested in using, or if you kind of saw any problems with it. So yeah, here's the conversation they have about the app. Aren't you concerned that your app might be used for sinister purposes? I worried about that a lot when it was in the initial stages. The reality is that any app, such as a hookup app, can be used to manipulate and hurt others, primarily women. I figured, isn't it better to try to foster human connection than not? I don't understand why we need more tools to connect with others. Sometimes we don't know the people we already know. The guy you're with, the guy who makes you feel lucky to be in love, that guy could turn out to be a rapist. So these platforms of social media, they all kind of run on the idea that human connection is something that can be kind of engineered, rather than something that is very kind of difficult to achieve. So even with one's romantic partner, it can be difficult to continually connect with them. So human connection, I think the protagonist is saying, is a little bit more complex than just forcing people into an encounter. I'm a very kind of introverted person, so this app terrifies me. I don't like meeting strangers, really. But I'd be interested in hearing kind of if you guys had different opinions on this app. Okay, so we have in the previous slide, we have the kind of the techno bro utopia of social media, of the internet, basically, where there's these kind of, a lot of them are men, kind of geniuses, doing all kinds of innovations or disruptions. But then this story kind of focuses on, I don't want to use gendered language to describe it, but maybe the more feminine labor involved with the internet. And I'm just going to draw a brief comparison here between the content moderation that these workers do and housework, which has been something that women have had to do for a very long time. And it's not the kind of glamorous, not as glamorous as the kind of disruption or innovations that the men of Silicon Valley are constantly chasing. So yeah, so this is from the story. Content moderation is unending warfare. So says the woman's boss, Shady Dave. As soon as you've defeated one set of troops, another is ready to take its place. And thus the battle ever endures, wave after wave, ad infinitum. Here's a quote from the feminist theorist Simone de Beauvoir. And notice it's very kind of similar language. Few tasks are more like the torture of Sisyphus, who is the dude who had to roll the boulder up the hill endlessly, then housework. With its endless repetition, the clean becomes soiled, the soiled is made clean, over and over, day after day. The housewife wears herself out, marking time. She makes nothing, simply perpetuates the present. The years no longer rise up towards heaven, they lie spread out ahead, gray and identical. The battle against dust and dirt is never won. So yeah, I think there's a lot of kind of connections here between cleaning up the internet, doing this kind of invisible work, which like when you go to a mall or something, you may see kind of like cleaning staff, but their work is kind of meant to be invisible. But there's also kind of a cleaning staff for the internet, which the protagonist is a member of. And yeah, this labor is incredibly difficult. There was a documentary made in 2018 called The Cleaners, and it kind of documents a lot of this work being done in the Philippines, where, yeah, I think there's a quote from the story that she says she's become like a sommelier in decapitations. So it's even difficult to imagine what something like that would be like, where you're exposed to that kind of traumatic imagery day after day. So in that documentary, The Cleaners, from 2018, one of the workers says that he has to look at 25,000 images a day. So 25,000 images a day from Facebook, and he has to go through them. These images have all been flagged for some reason, and he has to go through them to see if they're okay to be on Facebook or not. 25,000 images, that's a lot, and a lot of them are probably going to be traumatic in some way. So it's incredibly difficult work, but it's also work that has no glamour to it, as the de Beauvoir quote kind of suggests, that it's just this it's a monotony, and it doesn't have the kind of the what makes you feel good about working sometimes, where you're creating something. There's no creation. It's basically just deleting things from the internet. So it's completely negative labor. And obviously, as I think the story documents, this labor takes a toll on a person. And it's very important. Like, these kind of social media platforms wouldn't exist without content moderation, but it's also work that's completely not glamorous at all. And Mary South, the author of the story, kind of comments on this. She did an interview with The New Yorker. I think she's kind of commenting on the gender politics of it as well here. So more broadly, why is disruption such a focus in the tech world? Why do all these billionaires aspire to go to outer space? Perhaps it is because it is more fun to compete with each other than turn their attention to the unglamorous work of cleaning, caring, and maintaining. So yeah, this is the labor that has to fall to characters like the protagonist, while Elon Musk can try to go to space. Okay, so this is kind of just the final thing I wanted to touch on for this story, and that is our need for narrative. And this is something that will actually apply when I look at the feminist a little bit. So what I'm understanding narrative to mean here is just some ordering of the events of often our lives in a way that allows them to make sense, that presents kind of a beginning, an origin story, and then an ending. So something that happens to us that kind of provides like a capstone to our lives, that allows us to kind of make sense of them in a way, to generate meaning. And this is kind of reflected in the story, where the opening lines of the story are about, or I'll just read them. The rapist is such an inspiration that he started a newsletter to share his story. He chronicles his transformation from a nerdy duckling into the muscular entrepreneur swan he is today. So here the rapist is kind of demonstrating how each of us, I think, make our lives into a story. And social media kind of offers us the opportunity to broadcast that story to other people, but often in a way that's completely artificial. A lot of the times narrative is artificial. It removes certain details and amplifies others. And it kind of always has this ending that allows the rest of the story to make sense. So yeah, this is kind of just a success story that the rapist is kind of just pushing forward through social media. But that is kind of juxtaposed with the protagonist of You Will Never Be Forgotten, the woman, her inability to create a narrative out of what happened to her. And this is just a quote from the interview. One of the main reasons for her obsession with the rapist is that she craves a narrative. Why did this happen to her? Which is kind of a question that is never kind of resolved even by the end of the story. So there's one character that has kind of a very firm story that he presents to other people and they read it. And then there's another character who isn't really granted that privilege of being able to reorder this traumatic event into kind of a life narrative. She has this really kind of resonant line that she used to be interested in art, in her grades, in school. But now she looks back on that past person as a fraud. So that kind of aspect of her life has been stolen from her. Okay, and then another thing that the story is kind of looking at is how we generate narrative on the internet. And there's a real ease to generating narratives on the internet when you use like the world's most popular search engine, Google. If you have like some kind of urge to tell yourself a certain story, which we'll see in The Feminist, you can kind of find anything on the internet to back up your narrative, the narrative that you want to tell. So, and we see that in kind of the political sphere today, especially in America, where people can kind of tell whatever stories they want to tell, just using the internet to gather whatever facts that resonate with them. They can compile them into their own narrative. And that leads to critiquing kind of mainstream media sources as offering like false narratives or fake news or something like that, because people can create their own stories. But this character in You'll Never Be Forgotten, the protagonist, she struggles to create a story. So she follows the rapist online and in real life with greater persistence. She rereads each digital clue he leaves and then rereads the rereads. So she's reading all this kind of information that's available to her on the internet, but she can't really formulate it into any kind of story about this person, like him just being a villain or something like that. She just can't bring it together. And just another quote from Mary Self, just kind of talking about the things that I think I've already talked about. So let's go to the next one. Yeah, and this gets to the kind of the ending of the story, which is kind of a missed encounter. The story is kind of setting you up to believe that there will be this encounter with the lion that will give some kind of meaning to everything we've read to that point. But that's instead kind of taken out from under our feet and is replaced with this, I think it's like a prepubescent boy or something that takes a dump on our balcony. Which is kind of the opposite of a meaningful ending of a story, I think. But perhaps you disagree, and perhaps there is meaning that you can kind of sort out from that act of defecation or whatever. So, this is just from the story. The woman needs something nice to happen. The universe owes it to her. A small thing she can lock up within the secret, innermost depths of herself, so she has the strength to keep on screening the hate speech, the gore, the torture, the pornography, both adult and child, the horrific traffic accidents, the executions carried out by terrorists. The woman is going to see the mountain view mountain lion, the way mourners see a bird soaring in the air after a loved one's funeral and know that the loved one is at peace. That kind of poignant anecdote. Just a quote from the interview. I didn't want this character to have an epiphany per se, to make it seem like she was suddenly healed. But she's come to a kind of acceptance. The woman is ready to do the hard work of recovery, which is a type of work that's also invisible. So Mary Self kind of sets up opposition here between epiphany, which is supposed to be some kind of awakening or some kind of meaning that suddenly arrives to you, and acceptance. So I'd be interested again in how you guys see that difference between epiphany and acceptance. What exactly is the difference between those two things, and why is self kind of separating them? And yeah, this is kind of, I think, what self is doing with the ending of the story is when we read stuff on the internet, sometimes we do kind of want to arrive at some kind of final anecdote or some kind of point of meaning that will kind of bring everything that we've just read together into kind of a tiny bundle of meaning. But by having the story end on this kind of more ambiguous note, it does kind of force us to think what the character will do next, I think. So yeah, I'd be curious what you guys think about the ending. I'm just going to end on a little video that kind of offers like the missed encounter with the Mountain View line. It's from the movie Collateral, which is also kind of set in the same kind of area in California. And yeah, it the movie ends with this kind of encounter with wildlife that kind of gives the rest of the film meaning. And yeah, it's kind of the alternate ending, perhaps, of you will never be forgotten. So I'm just curious what you guys think, if the short story ended like the movie clip I'm going to show, what the effect would be, or why can't You Will Never Be Forgotten end this way? And there might again be something to do with gender here, because the movie Collateral is about these two men. Masculinity is kind of a running thread through the whole film, and this encounter with wildlife kind of encapsulates the whole meaning of the movie. So I'll just play the clip.
Once upon a time, I was on the mind to lay your burden down, leave you where you stood. You believed I could, you'd seen it done before. I could read your thoughts. Tell you what you saw and never say a word. But now all that is gone, all is done.
Okay, that's it. I'll see you guys in the next video.